This is State of the Unions. I'm Tim Schlittner, and on behalf of my co-host Julie Green, who is traveling, I want to welcome you to our latest episode where we're honored to be joined by a very distinguished guest, Director General of the International Labor Organization, Guy Ryder. Guy, thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me here.
Pleasure. So I thought we'd start with, what is the ILO and what are you focused on today?
Well, the International Labor Organization has got a long history behind it. We're the oldest international organization in the world, 100 years old this year.
Wow.
And we do, I think, something which is unique in this international system. We're the only organization in the world that gathers together not only governments, but also the representatives of workers and the representatives of employers in our organization, not as invited guests, but as people who vote and take the decisions. So we have the world of work gathered in 187 of our member states. And what we do basically is we negotiate international labor laws, so-called international labor conventions, mm-hmm. and we seek to have them applied around the world. And we try to deal with all of the emerging issues in the world of work. We've done it for 100 years. And right now, I think what we're having to focus on, and there is a myriad of issues to be thought about, is about change in the world of work and the future of work. I think we're all conscious that we're living at a time of unprecedented change at work because of technology, because of climate change and what we need to do about it, mm-hmm. because of demographics, which are very different in different parts of the world, populations growing in some places, stagnating in others. And then what about globalization, this rather uncertain today path of globalization? So we're not trying to predict the future. That's not a really profitable sort of endeavor. We're trying to shape the future. It's a bigger ambition. We want to make sure that the future works for working people. The ILO was founded right after the First World War on the basic idea that if you want to keep peace in the world and in our societies, you need social justice. You need a fair deal for workers. And that probably resonates with the AFL-CIO.
Very much so.
Unsurprisingly, Tim, because the man who was really there at the beginning of the ILO, the man who wrote the treaties or chaired the committee that wrote the treaties to set up the ILO, was one Samuel Gompers, who's
tremendous.
Probably well known in this house.
Oh, yeah, there's the Gompers room.
So, sure.
Yeah, that's really cool. So you guys did a report on the future of work. Obviously, you're looking at this. The AFL-CIO did one as well. And I think in the title is a reference to decent work. What is decent work? How do you define that?
Yeah, well, our decent work agenda has been around now for nearly 20 years. And what we basically say, and it sort of in a nutshell says what the ILO is all about. Mm-hmm. We think that work needs to be, firstly, work that provides a decent income, enables people to live decently, raise a family, share in the benefits of societal progress. We think that work needs to be work which is covered by social protection systems so that we're protected from the basic vagaries of life, from the bad things that can happen to you. We think that work needs to be work which respects your fundamental rights. That means the rights to organize. It means the right to collectively bargain, as well as protection against discrimination, protection against forced labor and child labor. And we think also that work needs to be in a setting where problems and conflicts which arise, and inevitably they do, are sorted out by processes of dialogue and negotiation, not by the unilateral diktat of any partner. Mm-hmm. If you put all these together, this defines what we call decent work. And as you say, this year, our 100 years anniversary, we put together a global commission on the future of work, a very distinguished commission, co-chaired by the President of South Africa, Cyril Ramaphosa, an old trade union leader.
Right.
And the Prime Minister of Sweden, Stefan Löfven, who used to run the Swedish Metalworkers Union. And we hammered out what we think are the key issues for the future of work. And we had a declaration on the future of work adopted at our conference in June.
How are the international labor laws or conventions, as you say, how are they applied in the member countries?
Yeah. Well, here's something that was decided right at the beginning of the ILO's history. When a convention is negotiated, one of these laws is negotiated in the ILO, each country has to decide if it wants to ratify it, to accept that convention. So it's a national decision whether to accept the legal obligations from a convention. Here's the bad news. The United States really is a very poor ratifier. It's ratified very few of the ILO's conventions. It's not ratified those conventions which define organizing and collective bargaining rights. So that's the first point I have to make. The decision to accept the legislation is a national decision. And that produces very uneven results around the world. There are countries which have ratified a lot and others who have ratified little. But notwithstanding those, you know, those realities, we have a system whereby we supervise the application of standards. We have annual reports on the application. We have complaint mechanisms. And when things are not as they should be, well, we are able to, you know, bring about change basically through persuasion, diplomatic pressures, technical cooperation. It works. Now, we don't have the teeth of trade sanctions that some would like to see in the ILO, but what we do see is many ILO conventions referencing trade agreements.
Mm-hmm.
So an example is, and it's very much on your minds at the AFL-CIO right now, Tim, the new trade deal with Mexico and Canada, big chapter on labor. And if you look at it, you'll see ILO conventions, these standards referenced throughout. And I think that's, you know, whatever you think of the trade agreement, having those references is very important.
That's big. That's an improvement.
It's big. The question is, how do you get them implemented?
Right.
I think that's what it comes down to, and enforced.
Yeah.
And that's the challenge down in Mexico right now.
So the United States has not ratified the Convention on Organizing and Collective Bargaining.
There are two, and they haven't ratified either of them. And here's something about this convention. It's, you know, this sounds a bit obscure. It's Convention Number 87 of the ILO, the right to organize and bargain collectively. You know, it's been ratified by most countries in the world, but half of the world's population is still not covered by those conventions. They've not been ratified. Why? Because the United States has not ratified. China has not ratified. India has not ratified. Brazil has not ratified. So we haven't got the comprehensive coverage that we really need. And it's something we work to try and, you know, change.
What's the explanation been from the United States on refusal to sign on?
The United States has always had an interesting attitude towards the ILO. First thing to say is the ILO didn't join the ILO in 1919. It stayed out until 1934.
The United States didn't join the ILO.
It took FDR to bring the United States in because, and we all see this in our politics, don't we? There are moments when the United States pulls back from engagement with the international community. It takes we tend to call it isolationist position.
Seeing it right now.
And it doesn't really think that international law should have an influence on what the American people and the American legislature decides. And there's this ambiguity. So the United States uses ILO conventions a great deal in trade agreements and its external policies. But the fact of the matter is it hasn't accepted the legal obligations that come from that that convention.
Well, that's very disappointing.
See if we can change it.
Yeah, we'll work on it. Last 100 years, you're celebrating 100-year anniversary of the ILO. Can you talk about the progress that's been made and the challenges that remain?
Look, The thing I always point to when asked that question, I've been asked it a lot these times, is you go around the world, you look at any country, be it a European country, an Asian, an American country, basically the frameworks of labor legislation, the things that are addressed, the protections which are contained in labor legislation, the definition of workers' rights, the idea, just the idea of social protection, the commitment to pursue full employment, and much else, health and safety regulations, they all find inspiration in things decided in the ILO. So taking the long-term sort of perspective, you can say that the ILO has had a major role in shaping the way our world of work is regulated. That doesn't mean everything is perfect, far from it, but the ILO has made an enormous contribution to shaping the way we stop. There's a wonderful phrase in the ILO's constitution which says labor is not a commodity, but it's the rules, regulations, ideas, and processes that the ILO has helped to develop which stop labor from being just one more product on the market. So that's the big picture. And then I can point to the episodes where we made dramatic differences. When Solidarność was formed in the 1980s, when Lech Walesa basically brought historic change in the world.
Poland.
Poland. Yeah. The end of communism, the Eastern Bloc. Mm-hmm. That was the ILO. We were there. We were working with them. There was a major process in the ILO. Walesa came to the ILO conference. The then director general of the ILO went to see him in prison. A drama. Chile, same thing. End mm-hmm. of the dictatorship. More recently, Myanmar. The end of the generals. Still big problems. We've been there. We've done those things. And I think we've shown, and I think U.S. leadership has been really important in all of this, that at key moments the ILO has been part of the movement of history. It sounds rather pompous to say it that way. And how are we able to do that? Because we're close to the realities of working lives. What we act on are people's lives. We're not sort of stuck in a sort of a stratosphere of diplomatic discourse. We actually deal with the things that make a difference to working people's lives. Now, I repeat, I don't think that we've got to the end of that road. There are many challenges ahead.
Yeah.
We're in an era of growing inequalities, and frankly, we need to understand that those growing inequalities are already generating very dangerous phenomena around the world. Just take a look at Chile today, take a look at Iran, take a look at Iraq, take a look at the Lebanon, take a look at a lot of European politics. Mm-hmm. There is rebellion around the world against the levels of inequality that we've generated. And if you go back to the roots of the ILO, we're one of the instruments that has to make a change in all of that.
What level of concern do you have about the state of politics and society in the United States today?
Look, I'm going to answer your question in a more general way. I'm really very concerned that even the language used in the conduct of politics and some of the expressions of views that are being used in the mainstream of our politics, it may apply in the US, but certainly applies in Europe where I live and work. These are things I think that we wouldn't have imagined being possible in 2019. And some people tend to sort of brush this off as saying, well, excessive language, you know, don't get too worried about it. I don't believe that. I think what we're seeing is actually the infiltration of certain values and the abandonment of other values for which our organization stands that we should not admit and that we should react against. So, yeah, I am concerned. I am concerned. And I think that it will be a mistake just to let this roll. We need to sort of basically stand up for the type of principles that have inspired the ILO for 100 years. Yeah, and the type of way we've done things. Tolerance. Listening to people. It's not just about using the microphone. It's about listening to.
So give listeners a little sense of your path to this position. You were born in the UK. How did you become involved in the labor movement?
Yeah, I was born in the northwest of the UK, the industrial northwest in Liverpool. Yeah. Grew up in a family which was a trade union family.
Right.
Pretty much turned on to these issues from the beginning. And mm-hmm. I grew up in the 1980s. This was the Thatcher years.
Yeah.
Some of your listeners might remember the great coal mining strike 1984 and 1985, which was a sort of a defining moment in the UK labour movement, and in fact the beginning of something very, very difficult. I went to work at that point, basically, fairly soon from out of college for the Trade Union Congress there, the equivalent of the AFL-CIO in the UK.
Yeah.
A very powerful organisation, 13 million members at the time. And, you know, I think my formative years were in the 1980s UK labour movement, and it was an era of confrontation. It was an era of confrontation, of great social and economic hardship. And that sort of led me to the view that there were better ways to do it than the way that it was happening in the 1980s.
Mm-hmm.
And if I found my way to the ILO, so I became, through various steps, I became General Secretary of the International Trade Union Confederation, worked very closely with successive presidents of the AFL-CIO, including Rich Trumka in that role, and then moved on to the ILO. But the point is this. I actually think and believe that there is advantage and possibilities in the representatives of organized labor sitting with the representatives of organized employers, with governments mediating on the global stage and actually hammering out deals, working out pathways to the future, which represent more than a zero-sum game. And I think there's a lot of things happening around the world that support that idea. And we need to act in this global, this era of globalization. We need to act on the global stage to look for global solutions. We really, however big your country is, however powerful it may be, it is illusory to think that there are purely national solutions to the global problems that we face. I think that's a basic proposition that organized labor got probably before governments got it. But we have every interest, given the direction of our politics, in establishing that point.
So employers and unions at the table with governments, what's the challenges to that? Have you seen employers throw up roadblocks, or have employers been more partners in the tripartite system that the ILO encourages?
Well, again, just a reference back to our history. One of the very important employer leaders in the ILO once said, well, the ILO was an unsolicited gift to the employers from the labor movement. Mm-hmm. Basically, it was organized labor that brought the ILO into existence. And yet the employers have found reason to engage with the ILO for 100 years. Different explanations for that at different times. During the Cold War years, this was very much predicated on the notion that there was an East-West struggle going on, mm-hmm. and employers and organized labor found a community of interests in fighting for a certain set of values. So at the time of the end of the Cold War, and this was Reagan, this was Thatcher, the employers really asked themselves a question. You know, do we have a reason to engage in the ILO? And we know they really asked themselves that question. And they decided that there was. And I think, seen at least in its positive interpretation, the notion is we're establishing a globalized economy. This was the end of history idea. You know, the market was going to run everything.
Yeah.
I think enlightened business interests, and they're the ones that prevailed, said, yeah, okay, we're establishing a globalized marketplace here, but we need some rules for the game. We need a social dimension. You know, in a sense, it's saving capitalism from its own excesses. And that's, you know, in a nutshell, where the ILO is. Now, this sort of thing has been going on now for 30 years. We've seen globalization, you know, move forward quickly, hesitate. More questioned today than ever. We see what's happening in the field of trade. We see the United States and China sparring mm-hmm. around these things. You know, the employer interest is in having a rules-based system. Now, you've got to agree on the rules, and that's no easy thing. But they do need to have those rules established, and they do demonstrate an interest in it. And that is a very delicate set of issues and a very delicate equilibrium. But in the end, that's basically what I think ties the business community into the work of our organization.
You mentioned Rich Trumka, and he has talked a lot about inequality being a threat to democracy, and that when the system doesn't work for working people, they eventually look for another system. I wonder if that's something you've seen around the world.
Well, of course, Rich is absolutely right about that. And I think, as I've said, events around the world are bearing out the wisdom of what he says. And we are seeing, and it's expressed in different ways, isn't it? Sometimes, you know, through the formal structures of trade unions, sometimes through the appeals of populist sections of the political spectrum, sometimes in simply street rebellion, just mm-hmm. simply, very immediate mobilization by people with no obvious marching orders behind them. But people will react. People will react against the inequalities that we are facing today. You know, we've been arguing, the ILO has been arguing, you know, for greater equity at work and in society for 100 years. We're getting some interesting allies today. The International Monetary Fund is very outspoken in saying that current levels of inequality actually is a problem for growth and job creation. So we're coming from a social sort of side on this. The hard-headed economists are saying, hey, inequality is a problem for us too.
It's bad economics.
Bad economics. And I guess the people who are more worried about the security and stability side of our societies, nationally and internationally, are saying, hey, this level of inequality is a security problem. So if you line these things up, and they haven't always been lined up, but you have a lineup, an alignment of the economic, the social, and the security case for addressing inequality, then I think we've got something new and something which all of us should try to make the best use of.
Does the ILO have an opinion on strikes?
Yeah, touching on a really important issue. This famous convention number 87, the one I've mentioned to you, which defines the right to organize, it was established in 1948, and it's always been understood to contain a right to strike. It does not use those words. You won't find the words right to strike in that convention, which fits very neatly on one side of paper. Mm. It's a very concise statement.
Yeah.
But it's always been construed by our legal authorities to say that there is an international recognition of the right to strike. Latterly, I would say in the last 7 years that I've been in my office, the employers' constituency in the ILO have argued that this is legally flawed reasoning, that there is no right to strike implied by Convention 87. They say, yes, we understand that at national level, arrangements should be made to protect strike action as a legitimate defense of interest, but it ain't in international legislation. That's an ongoing fight at the ILO. But the point I want to make is that for over half a century, the ILO has been defending, with certain caveats, because there are limits on what it means, the right to strike is recognized at the ILO.
Would there be any appetite, you think, to actually writing the words into the convention? Or how does that work, opening up a convention?
You could do it.
Yeah.
I think trade unions, it's not for me to offer the opinion, but I think trade unions have taken the view that if you open up that convention under current political circumstances, you might go two steps backwards instead of one step forward. So there's risks involved in that, Tim, so as you'll understand.
Gotcha. So you mentioned climate change as one of the global issues facing working people around the world. How do we tackle this in a way that works for workers?
It's a really, it's perhaps, you know, the issue which is more starkly before us today than any other and which we cannot wait to address. So I would start from the premise that climate change is real. Mm-hmm. The science shows it. And climate change is already impacting on the world of work and destroying many people's livelihoods. It needs to be addressed. I know not everybody takes that view, but I think that is the view that the ILO would follow. Secondly, you know, for a long time, and I can well understand it, I think we took the view, many people in the world of work took the view, you've got to either choose. You've got to choose. Either we go for growth, development, job creation, or we go for protection of the planet. I think the science and a lot of the work that's been done subsequently says, this is a false choice, having to choose between the two.
Right.
The two things can coincide, and we've done research to show that. There is a big jobs dividend if we choose the right processes of change to deal with climate change. Not automatic. So written into the Paris Climate Change Agreement, which the US is withdrawing from, is a notion of just transition. These are the words. This means transition to climate neutral future, which protects and promotes the decent work agenda that we've talked about. The market won't do it. The market will not make this happen by itself. Governments have to commit to just transition processes. They have to work with organized labor and the business community to make it a reality. One of the important things that happened at the United Nations Climate Summit recently was nearly 50 countries signed up to just transition processes. That is to say, consciously, as a matter of national policy, they will make path towards a climate-neutral future one that actively promotes employment and decent jobs. Easy to say, I recognize this, extremely difficult to do, but it's a challenge that we have to get right. And I think organized labor, and I understand the extractive industries, energy-intensive industries have got the biggest challenges to confront. We have to take on those challenges. We have to do it with those people involved, not against them. And we have to do it offering a pathway to a future where people will have jobs.
Was the United States one of the 50 countries that signed on to a just transition?
No.
Okay. What is the current global view of the American labor movement as you see it?
Well, the first point to make is that today, as always, the U.S. labor movement matters enormously in your own country, but it matters enormously on the global stage. And this is something which I hope that listeners in the United States will take note of. You know, the US and the AFL-CIO for as long as any of us can remember has not only defended and promoted the benefit of the lives of US working people, they've done it around the world. And it's a record of solidarity which you should be proud of, which I think is to the advantage of US workers too, because what happens in other countries has a bearing on what happens in the United States.
Absolutely.
And we need to keep this up.
Yeah.
And you know, I really thank the AFL-CIO for all of that. We understand that the US labor movement, which has a very particular history and a pretty heroic history in many ways, faces a very tough climate here in the United States. We've already talked about the fact that the United States has not ratified Convention 87. I know that organizing is a tough job in the United States. I've been out over the years with friends from the AFL-CIO and seen some of the circumstances in which U.S. Trade unions have to seek to organize. So it's a tough time. We recognize that it's a tough place. We recognize that U.S. labor has to deal with a business model, which we tend to see born in the United States, but around the world, which is not always amicable to the role of organized labor.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there's a great deal of admiration, a great deal of understanding, a great deal of interest in what's happening here. I think some of the latest headlines that have been made by the U.S. labor movement around the world is really quite impressive. We saw the UAW strike, which made headlines around the world.
Right.
Made people's ears sort of pick up, you know, and say,
General
wow,
Wars.
Something's going on
yeah.
in the United States.
Yeah.
So it seems from what I can understand, but I'm a visitor here, mm-hmm. That with all of the challenges which U.S. labor does face undeniably, it's more than alive and kicking. And people look to to trade unions here as something of an inspiration and understanding that what happens here in the United States inevitably has consequences around the world. So an enormous interest.
That's great. I was reading that the ILO had a role in responding to the Great Depression.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that for a second?
Well, you know, there's a terrific, you know, you can understand during our centenary year, we've been sort of digging out the history books
yeah,
and seeing what's
back.
Happened, and it's fantastic. You start with Sam Gompers
mm-hmm.
Way back in 1919, and then the fact that the U.S. was absent from the ILO until 1934. And then you get this extraordinary history. FDR, Francis Perkins, the Secretary of Labor, who had a dramatic role in the ILO. We saw how the New Deal lined up with the ILO. I mean, it was a natural alignment. When FDR connected with the ILO and the ILO connected with what was happening in the States, and don't forget, the ILO had to go into exile in the Second World War. We established up in Montreal. The United States didn't want us here, but we went up to Montreal.
Wow.
There was an extraordinary coming together of U.S. political developments and the ILO. Two of the most dramatic conferences in the history of the ILO took place during the Second World War in the United States. 1941 conference in New York, which set the template for post-war construction. 1944 Declaration of Philadelphia at a conference there. Basically, the United States leadership set the template for the post-war reconstruction. And I guess looking back on it, it seems like a golden era for labor and social progress mm-hmm. in the United States and in the world. And this was made in the United States. This was U.S. leadership at work in the most positive sense possible. So if you look at the New Deal, you know, and all of the labor aspects of the New Deal, you know, the heroic stuff, John L. Lewis, whole lot of it, that sort of translated into a global process that made, you know, the post-Second World War social system what it was. And this was building the societies that we live in today and some of the things that we need to protect today.
Do you think we could use a global New Deal?
Something like that. We certainly need to take a new look at the way our global economy is operating. I think everybody agrees with that. I think a number of things are quite obvious. We've talked about the need to tackle inequality. I think we have to put jobs back at the top of the agenda. And I think we have to put wages back on the agenda. I mean, the notion that the world needs a pay raise, if you look at the way globally, the way that the share that wages occupy in national income around the world has decreased for 30 years. There's basically been a long-term shift of resources away from workers and towards capital. that needs fixing. That needs fixing. And not just in the United States, around the world. So if you want to call it a global new deal, let's call it a global new deal, but we need to fix these things.
What do the employers at the ILO say about the lack of a pay raise for workers around the world?
Yeah, well, as you probably understand, it's probably not the thing they talk about most. And yet, you know, it's not quite as black and white as you might imagine. Mm-hmm. You know, I think also employers know that, you know, as I said earlier on, you know, capitalism does need to be protected from its worst excesses. Yeah. You know, you can screw down wages to a certain point, but you get the reaction, and that will break the machine. So I think there's enough foresight and enlightened sort of self-interest at play in the employer community to say, well, you know, we can't simply wipe these issues off the table. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, interests don't coincide exactly on this debate, but there is more space for a debate than one might imagine.
We always like to end with rapid fire.
Yep.
Have our guests answer quick questions.
Sure.
Do you have a favorite U.S. president?
Roosevelt.
Okay. I agree with you.
FD.
Yeah, to be clear. Fits in with our New Deal discussion. A few words to describe what's happening in the U.K.
It's. I honestly think it's dramatic in a negative sense. Mm-hmm. I think Brexit runs a risk of damaging my country for decades, and I hope we can find a way through the labyrinth.
Do you have an example of a global company that is doing the right thing for workers right now?
Yeah, I don't want to sort of give an advert for any country, any company, but I mean, for example, I was witness to a global framework agreement signed between Industrial, a global union federation, and mm-hmm. a company in Belgium called Umicore, which deals in cobalt supply chains. They want to tidy up supply chains so there's no child labor, no forced labor, and basic rights are protected. There are good companies out there.
Great. Thoughts on the new NAFTA agreement moving through?
Yeah, I mean, everybody has their views on the agreement. What I think is interesting is that labor chapter, which is in there, which, as I've said, references ILO conventions, you know, in a most explicit way, enforcement and implementation. That's what matters, I think, in this agreement. And it's not a given.
Emerging labor movement to watch around the world.
In any country.
Any country, yeah. Any.
Look, I would say it has to be. You've got to look to the Asian continent. Mm-hmm. There, some of the quickly growing Southeast Asian states. I could say Latin America, but Latin America have had labor movements for a long time. Right. I don't describe them as emerging. So look to Indonesia. Look to Thailand. Look to Malaysia. Those are the places where we need strong labor.
Favorite English Premier team.
Football, soccer, as you would call it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm born in Liverpool. There are two teams in Liverpool, and my team is Everton.
Everton, okay. Thank you so much for joining us today. This has been our discussion with Guy Ryder. He's the 10th Director General of the International Labor Organization, celebrating 100 years of the ILO. Thanks for everything you do.
Thanks, Tim.
This is State of the Unions.